The race for the leadership of the Democrats is about to start, and this man means to win it. Paddy Ashdown, MP for Yeovil, is 47 years old, but looks 10 years younger. He's fit, he's tough, he's extremely ambitious, and he could be about to become Britain's newest party leader.
I've never known what my destiny was. In many ways, I've actually found myself driven by forces which are outside me, outside my control, and that is a situation I certainly feel at present.
He looks too good to be true, and his critics say he is. After only 5 years as an MP, they claim he's inexperienced, a politician who's trying to run before he can walk.
I think the problem would probably come during the very tough business of leading a political party in an election campaign, when experts are going to grill you about the detailed aspects of policy, and when it isn't possible then to fudge and to mudge and to slide around. That's where I think the problem would occur.
I think that's probably people's biggest question mark over Paddy Ashdown. It's not his work rate, it's not his effort. It's does he, at the end of the day, have the very fine, careful judgment that a good leader has got to have quickly in difficult political situations? And goodness knows, I mean, this job is a difficult one for anybody. Does he have the combination of effort and judgment?
Mrs. Green.
Yes?
Hi, Paddy Ashdown. Paddy Ashdown, I'm the Liberal Democrat Member of Parliament for Yeovil, and this is my colleague and friend Tony.
Oh, yeah, I met you, didn't I, when I was giving out leaflets?
Paddy Ashdown, I'm the Liberal Democrat Member of Parliament.
Must be election time coming up.
That's right, it is. I'm a Liberal Democrat MP from Yeovil. Got a vote this time?
Even his opponents would concede that Ashdown's a superb campaigner. In a party not over blessed with charisma, he has undoubted star quality.
Yeah, well, you're going to miss it, I'm afraid. She's better than
that. He regularly works a 15-hour day, whether it's out canvassing for local councillors or visiting schools in his role as the Democrats' education spokesman. 2 weeks ago, he was at Rickmansworth, taking the message to the sixth form politics class.
And I'm delighted that now, having formed a single party, we'll actually get a single leader in this year. And when we've done it, we've got to start motoring to get ourselves back on the political scene, because frankly, we ain't made much of a success the last 4 or 5 months.
When you say that you would be prepared to try and push your party to the front of British politics, does that indicate that you'll be standing for the post of leader?
Well, you've got all the questions, haven't you, here? The answer to that is I don't have to. I mean, we're going to launch this thing on May the 31st. It would be saying, it would be giving away no secrets at all if I would say that I was thinking about it pretty seriously. But I don't have to make up my mind finally till May the 31st. And in politics, you keep your options open as long as you can.
But would your decision be a bit based on whether David Steele decides to stand?
No. My decision would be based on whether I thought it was a good thing for the party and whether I thought I was the right person to do it. I bet that's the bit that comes out on my television instead.
He clearly wants the leadership. I wouldn't doubt that for a moment. I think he's very ambitious for it. And that, I think, is a quality. I mean, goodness knows, one wants people to want to do the job. So I think you'd be a strong candidate. I think he'll try very hard. He may try too hard. He may try to be the perfect speaker, the best performer on television. I suspect he might not relax enough in the campaign, in the way he presents himself, and may not prove to be as good as some people hope he will be.
I arrived with a broad Belfast accent, which is what I had from my upbringing, and they christened me Paddy. Many, many of my friends then left the school with me and went into the services at the same time. Indeed, went into the Royal Marines at the same time, so the nickname carried over and it stuck with me ever since.
It was a very responsible position. It was a young officer's, a young commander's war, and your initiative and your reliability and responsibilities were very high.
How you would use intelligence to gain intelligence and how you would use daring in order to be able to achieve what you wanted to achieve. So all those ingredients were in the special vote section, and I must say it was a very formative and enjoyable and impressioned part of my life.
Did you see violent action? As you...
Yes, so we had a number of occasions when you came into contact with the enemy under circumstances which naturally produced very violent action.
I have experienced violence, I've experienced death, I've seen what it does.
Did you ever kill anyone yourself?
Oh, I really can't say that. I mean, not that I can't say it because I'm not entitled to say it or allowed to say it, because you don't know in the fog of battle. You haven't a clue what actually happens to the particular bullets that you may happen to fire. It's far too much of a maelstrom for that. But I am committed to the idea that we can and must achieve a more peaceful world, that the opportunities for us to stop that terrible process of war, the destruction of lives, the blighting of economies, the creation of poverty, the robbing, as Eisenhower called it, of the from the poor in the arms race, we can bring that to a close, and my commitment to that springs out of having seen the effect of war.
In the 1970 general election, Ashdown voted Liberal for the first time, and this rather gung-ho young Royal Marine officer took his first steps on the road to Westminster. He took a degree in Chinese at Hong Kong University, and after a brief tour of duty in Northern Ireland, he left the Marines altogether and joined the Foreign Office.
He was motivated to an unusual degree by a social conscience, by a certain idealism. Had he been merely ambitious for power, which some people think all politicians are, frankly, he wouldn't have joined the Liberal Party, would he? He'd have tried one of the others. So I don't think it was that. I think he was somebody who genuinely wanted to do something to make the world a better place, rather than merely, as in Geneva, sit in endless comfortable committees talking about making the world a better place.
My wife and I decided quite simply that we wanted to put our lives somewhere where we thought it would really matter. And I think whilst we enjoyed the services and enjoyed studying Chinese and enjoyed being in the diplomatic service, we didn't feel that it would actually change for the better the world in which we lived. That may seem a romantic reason, but that was the reason, and I'm glad I did it.
Ashdown gave all that up and returned home with no job to Yeovil, where the local Liberals were looking for a new parliamentary candidate. Apart from a few large factories like Westland Helicopters, Yeovil is a rural seat and at the time was solidly Conservative. Ashdown decided to have a go.
When you took the decision to go into politics, did you have any idea, really, what you were getting into?
None whatsoever. My old colleague David Penhaligon used to have a wonderful phrase. When asked how he won Truro, he used to say, I was too naive to know it was impossible. And I think in many ways I was too naive to know that winning Yeovil was impossible.
When Paddy Ashdown arrived here in 1976, the Liberals had this very fine old listed building as a headquarters, and that was about all. Yeovil had been a Tory seat since before the First World War. Out of a total of 40 local councillors, the Liberals had just one. It didn't look a very promising place from which to begin a political career, but over the next 7 years, often at considerable personal cost, Paddy Ashdown changed all that.
Well, I was very much his staff officer, and he was the commanding officer. There's no doubt about that. But I think in terms of his dealings with Marines, and so on, his man management, his leadership, stood him in good stead.
He's a good tactician. The way he uses his troops and his lieutenants under him, he's really good at making everybody work locally, his councillors, his casework assistants. So in that way, you can see that. His discipline and his tenacity. He's extremely tough.
The effects on the Liberals' fortunes were dramatic. From a command post in the town centre, they ran campaigns which took them from one district councillor in 1976 to 34 out of 40 today. On the county council, they went from no seats at all to 12. The Liberal share of the vote doubled.
In the old days, I mean, these things...
Building the Liberal machine in Yeovil cost Ashdown dear. For 7 years, with no guarantee of success at the end of it, he and his wife had to bring up two adolescent children on a salary half what they'd been used to. For more than a year, he was out of work. The experience of unemployment not only showed the depth of Ashdown's political commitment, it changed him.
To see a man like Paddy, who, I suppose,
takes providing for his family very seriously. Going through that period of unemployment where the children's genes got higher and higher up their legs, it was very hard on him. To keep his morale up was quite difficult.
There was one moment when we came within, I suppose, a fortnight of packing it in, simply because we didn't have any money left. We'd run out. I was unemployed, my second period of unemployment. And my wife and I said, we'll go away for a weekend. We needed a break. And we'll try. If I don't find a job by the time I come back, I'll have to go looking outside my constituency. I was determined not to move from there. And then the next day, a cheque arrived from Roundtree, God knows how they knew, through the post, and said, here's to help you continue. And we continued. I got a job in the week after, and it all went on from there. And I underestimated the scope and the requirement for a breadth of knowledge that I didn't have. And I overestimated my own capacity to do it alone. I think all my life have been something of a free climber. And I discovered, after making some pretty serious mistakes in politics, that this was a job which I could not do by myself.
Okay,
select edit option.
So now, if you want to zoom in on that...
Right.
Ashdown, a great enthusiast for new technology, contemptuous of old-fashioned methods, was a bit too much of a whiz kid, a bit too much of an eager boy scout for some of his more staid colleagues in Parliament.
I'm not used to using a mouse.
He was a loner, not a team player, and he didn't go out of his way to win friends.
The first Christmas Paddy was in the House of Commons, he sent all his Alliance colleagues not only House of Commons Christmas cards, which we all have, of course, in large numbers to send to our constituents, but he sent us House of Commons Christmas cards on which his name had been printed. No personal message, no handwritten name or anything. And it struck me that that sense of impersonal approach, that lack of sensitivity towards colleagues, it came through in that sort of rather silly little gesture.
Were you very hurt by those charges of Paddy back down, that the name was thrown at you at the time?
Yes, and it's something that will no doubt stick with me. It's a clever comment, and I think it's not a wholly under the circumstances inaccurate one.
Because he doesn't want to upset people, he hasn't been willing to take a firm, definite, clear position one way or the other. He's tried to keep too many balls in the air at any given time. He does accept that nuclear weapons are necessary in some situations. Trouble is, he's veered backwards and forwards against cruise in 1984, prepared to accept it in 1985, having no particular position about the possible replacement of Polaris, not willing to indicate whether he was in favour of it or against it. And then on Trident, he was totally opposed to it. Now he's made statements saying that there's a case for accepting it and negotiating with it. And the difficulty, I think, is to pin him down at any given time, firmly and clearly and sharply.
When we come to power at the next election, if we do, then we have to accept that Trident is there. You can't pretend it isn't. And the question is, how do you use it? If you were to say we'll get rid of it by Sunday afternoon lunchtime, as the Labour Party seems to claim, I don't think that advances things one whit. What we would wish to do, and what I would wish to do, would be to use Trident within the context of the international world disarmament at the time to ensure that Britain plays a part, and we stimulate the process of disarmament across the world, which is the real prize much to be achieved.
Are you getting enough people out working for it?
Oh, yes.
There's never enough, is there?
There are never enough. Do you know I was a Liberal candidate?
Really? By dint of sheer hard work, Ashdown has made up much of the ground he lost. No Democrat MP has spent more time in the country building up contacts with ordinary party members.
And there was that wonderful display of posters right opposite the station. Extremely famous.
This is more part.
Yeah.
Ashdown may not be particularly popular with his fellow MPs, but here he's in his element, and these are the people who'll be voting in the leadership election in July. It's this following which makes him such a strong contender, not a prospect his wife finds pleasing.
Do you want him to be leader of a political party?
No.
You sound very definite about that.
I am very definite about it. I think all our privacy will go down the plug hole. Hearing what happens to other people in that situation, I would not like that myself.
Oxford 2 weeks ago, and members of the SLD arrived for their inaugural meeting. Guest speaker, Paddy Ashdown. Ashdown has already done four of these regional launches. He's pitching his appeal at the left of the new party. The Democrats have to be radical, he says. They must aim to replace the Labour Party. It's a leadership campaign speech in only the thinnest of disguises, but it goes down well.
Say to my Liberal colleagues, proud though I am of our old party, that we live perhaps for too long on the intellectual capital of the Joe Grimmond era. Time for new thinking. Time to think ahead. Time for new ideas. Time for some intellectual ferment. Time to have the courage to think about the future. Mrs. Thatcher will not be removed by defending the past. I want our party to be the progressive, left of centre, alternative to conservatism in Britain. And that means that our job is not to ally with the Labour Party, but to replace the Labour Party. Yeah. That's our function, that's our destiny.
And leading that campaign, Ashdown hopes, will be his destiny. The Democrats clearly like him. Now they have to decide whether they trust him to lead them into battle.
I think to some extent he has to be classified as a high-risk choice. He's got to prove that he can take his parliamentary colleagues with him. He's got to get the support of the party in the country. And he's then got to deliver. And, I mean, that's the worst part of this. It's not winning this election for the leadership. It's actually performing over another 3 years and taking us through a very difficult general election campaign. So, yes, he will be a risk, but I think many people would say he's an exciting risk and worth it.
Robert Harris on What Makes Paddy Run. And now to the race itself and our poll, which I mentioned at the beginning. Over the last 4 days, we've asked more than 800 people, all of them activists in the new party, who they would want as leader of the Democrats if David Steele were to withdraw, as of course he did this evening.
The result was as follows. Paddy Ashdown, 67%, Alan Beath, 10%, Malcolm Bruce, 7%, and Robert McLennan, 1%.
That's, of course, a remarkable boost for Paddy Ashdown, and especially as the activists have been widely supposed to favour Beath. Ashdown was presumed to be the favourite of the so-called armchair members of the party, who were excluded from our poll, but will, of course, have a vote in the election. And now, by way of postscript, it looks as though David Steele might have made an astute decision, because we also asked, who's your choice of leader if Steele does run? The outcome, Ashdown, 57%, David Steele, 15%, which would have meant the prospect of a crushing defeat, of course, for the man who said tonight that he is not a candidate. Until next Thursday, good night.